I'm doing a second half of the video on piston production, and I'm trying to get this done quickly. I did some machining and then I've got video that I'll link after the fact. This is a throwaway of one of them that I featured in the last short video. This has got some flaws, but it's good for just this purpose. These are the little plugs that I manufacture here. They're made out of just 360 brass. I cut them out of an 11/16 bar. They're pocketed, and their job basically is to go in the top and into the bottom of the piston. So they fit in, and this one's loose, so again, it's not that big a deal. Sometimes when I make them correctly, I usually use a vise to set them in. And it's more of a feel as to how tight they actually need to be. You don't want to have to force, you don't want to force the part in. If it's too large, pick another part or make better parts. You want it to seep, but you don't want it to squeeze to the point where it's swelling the Monel or potentially squashing or crushing the overall length. From here, what I'm going to do with this is, and I won't talk through this, it's going to be cleaned and then it's going to be prepped for brazing. And I will braze the top, the bottom, and all of the ports on the outside. So every tube will then be connected and it all becomes one piece. And then I'll show you the machining and potentially the honing and all that stuff, but that's what I'll do for now. There may be some talking in it, there may not be. At any rate, this is the second half of the piston video. Thank you. Okay, I'm behind the camera at this point. This is the pump after the brazing and after it's soaked and cleaned. Each pump has these extra long parts, legs on it. Now the brazing on this piece is really sloppy and I really don't care. This was a throwaway pump. It's got holes in the liner. I didn't want to take the time to fix it. It's just for the video, just for example. So I will show what happens next. I took the legs off basically. So give me a minute, set the camera up and I'll be back. Okay. Try to keep this, I'm kind of bent over to kind of get this in the frame. What I'm going to remove are the excess legs off of the outside of the piston. The easiest way that I found to do this and the safest way to do it is to honestly to sand them off. So I've got a couple of pieces of Delrin that I use to hold onto them and gloves because it does get really hot. And I just take them off. I do not touch the Monel with the sander though. So let me do this real quick and show you how it's done. It starts to come right off. And you just work your way around the pump. Now, I have a reason for doing this that I'll explain. Once the machine is off. Okay, so that's all of the legs sanded roughly off of the outside of the piston. I don't go any further than that with this step. If, let me pick the stand up. Okay, so here's our piston and it's roughly sanded. I do not do that step on the lathe. There's a good reason. If you've got those legs hanging off of the outside of the piston that are sometimes a half an inch long or longer, and you try to take that off on a lathe, it's going to tear them out of the piston before it will actually cut them off. So the next step that I'm going to do is set the machine up. I'll set up my Logan lathe and we'll start turning the outside down. And that's in the next clip. Alright, I'm holding the camera by hand. I can't get the tripod in the correct spot. This pump has had one initial cut taken off of it. You can see the outsides of the liners are all nice and shiny. It means the cutter has just touched those. So let's take a second cut and I'll hold the camera as I'm doing this. Cool.
these initial cuts are set up so that I can get this piston into the fixture, put a spring barrel on it.
Okay, so you can see we've taken more material off. There are some high spots and some low spots. You can see the excess braze. Again, I don't care about the excess braze. It's not going to hurt anything at this point. And what I'm going to do is take another cut or two and keep working my way in. Okay, to do a cut like this on a piston, it's called an interrupted cut. The material is Monel. You've got three materials that are very difficult to work with: Inconel, Monel, and titanium. Luckily, I don't have to work with those when it comes to trumpet, but Monel is insanely difficult to machine on a lathe. It work hardens almost immediately with even good tooling. It's really difficult to cut. So what I want to look for first is I don't have any runout, so that it's one size from the top to the bottom. So while I'm doing this, I'm measuring everything as I go, because I don't have a lot of room to make mistakes, basically. I'm watching the finish of the part, because if the cutter starts to gouge, I have to stop and change the cutter. So I do use really good carbide inserts. It's a small lathe, so I'm using a positive rake instead of a negative rake tool. I could explain that, but it would probably bore everybody. If you're a machinist or you've worked with a lathe, you know what I'm talking about. So let me set the machine back up and take another cut. Okay, you can see that we're starting to actually get into cutting the Monel at this point. And you'll also notice that it is not even. One side is cutting, the other side is not. That's very, very common. So what I'm going to do from here is I'm going to measure, I can see, I'm going to measure this side to this side. And I'm going to compare the two and make sure we don't have any actual deviation in the size. I don't want to cut a taper. I want this to be nice and straight, so let me check that. Okay, so I'm checking for not concentricity of the tube, but I'm checking for taper to make sure I'm not running any taper. Right now I'm getting a reading of 676 on the top. And about 676 on the bottom. From a machining standpoint, that's not bad. I'm okay with that. Okay, so the reason we do the lathe work is first to get those parts turned down so I can install spring barrels into them. And I use a jig like this. This is not the jig I actually use, but this is similar to what it looks like. So you've got a keyway that you can access up here with solder and a torch. This has a hole that's rotatable, so you can set the radial location of the slot. And then if you look through the little window, you can see it can line up with one of the ports. So you have a little locking key that goes in, it holds the pump in a specific position, and it's adjusted, and you set it up and you never have to move it once you do this. This one is a prototype. I never actually finished it, but it's functionally just like what you need to use. I just haven't finished the height on it, so. A little bit more about the machining. I don't know if I said anything about how difficult it is to machine something like this, and why I choose to do it this way. When you're machining something like a pump, it's an interrupted cut. Every time the cutter is not touching the part, it wants to bounce. So it's very important that the machine is as stable as you can make it. Every gib is locked down. Everything is set so that it can't actually move. You want to minimize the vibration that's happening. You get vibration from the belt, you'll get vibration from the motor, you'll get vibration from the machine running. And you want to minimize that as much as you can because it'll transfer into your part. Monel, as I had said a bunch of times already, is kind of difficult to work with. Other manufacturers have gone to centerless grinding of their pumps, and it's a cool process and it does work. But in my last job, we had several occasions where we sent a batch, and by a batch I mean 35, sometimes 50 sets of pumps to a centerless grinder, and they were ground undersized, and we got them back and they were all unusable. I don't want to deal with that. Right now, it's easier for me to set the machine, make the cut, and you can see, let me see if I can get this set over here. Yeah, there it is. The finish I'm getting is actually really solid from Monel. I'm taking roughly 5 thousandths at a pass off. Monel does not like to be forced into cutting. And I don't have a lot of slop that I'm going to cut off the outside of the part to make this thing. So I do 5 thousandths at a pass. They go quickly. I make sure that I'm not running a taper either from top to bottom or bottom to top. And then they'll get the spring barrel installed and they'll go into the hone. They get some rough honing down to a specific size and then finished honing. The finished hone size is 633.5. That's what I shoot for. And it makes it easier when you're honing the trumpet itself than to fit each pump because you know what the sizes are. So I'm going to finish cutting the outside of this one down. Right now I'm at 76 and I usually take them down to 67, 68, so I don't have to hone that much. All right, so I've got the piston out of the lathe. Before we do the last few machining steps, what happens is I'll hand scrape each of the ports. Hold it up so you can see it. I'll take all the burrs out of each port. Now this piston, as I said when I started, this one is a throwaway. It's got some issues with two of the liners, and I didn't want to take the time to fix it. What I would normally do is cut the liners out and replace them, but I didn't need this piston for anything, so it serves a purpose this way. It's got flaws, but I don't want to show them to you. Basically, what I'm going to do is I'm going to machine the bottom down. I've got excess brass on the top and on the bottom, and I'll take both of those down to give myself a specific length, and then I'm going to pocket the top to accept the spring barrel. The spring barrel is this little dude here. I draw the material down to 542 by 500. I cut it to the length. I thread the inside of it to accept the action rod. And then I cut the slot as well. So it's going to pop into the top of this, go into the fixture, and get soldered. Afterwards, there's more machining, because what you need to do after the fact is you need to check for concentricity from the spring barrel to the piston itself. You want to make sure it's not wobbling in the lathe. So there are procedures to do that. Basically, what I do is I go with an internal mandrel and I hold it on the outside of the spring barrel and then rotate this in the lathe with the dial indicator on the head and on the tail of each piston. And I check for runout. Runout is if it's running wobbly. It shouldn't have any runout. Whether I show you that process or not, I'm not sure yet. It's getting to be a longer video than I want it to be. And it's not a tutorial on how you can make pumps. This is just what I do to produce pistons here. And I do call them pumps from time to time. It's irrelevant. So I'm going to pocket the bottom, pocket the top, put a spring barrel in it, and then remachine it on the lathe. And in this case, I would take it down so the outside diameter is roughly 3 to 4 thousandths of an inch larger than it's going to finish at in the hone. Any larger than that in the honing is insanely long. Any less than that, and you may not clean up all of the machining marks. A finished piston compared to one of these, you can see the light. This looks gray. This is nice and shiny. The reason it has a gray appearance is because it's been honed. This one's not yet been lapped in. But this has got the spring barrel installed. It's correct for length. I trimmed the spring barrel for length. It's already been checked for concentricity and bore size and all that fun stuff. So I may show more in the video, but just not tonight. It's dark and my kids are probably wondering what the hell I'm doing. So okay, so I just machined the bottom of the piston and took the extra length off first. And then I usually use the bottom of the setup if I'm doing sets of pistons. I never just make one piston. It's kind of crazy to try to do that. I'll set the bottom up so that it's the same interior bore size that I need for the spring barrel. That's the spring barrel. These are made a little bit longer than I need them on purpose. So when I flip the piston over, when I'm doing a set of these, I'm capable of actually setting it up once and then going ahead and setting each one of these in. What I'm looking for, when you're looking at a piston, you can tell the top and the bottom by the two stacked holes. This is the second piston, and this would be where the second slide lines up. And they'll be closer to the top than to the bottom. Once you've looked at them for a long enough time, they're really hard to not see top from bottom. So what I'm looking for is a fit that I actually have to kind of work to get it in. I do not want it to be loose. If it's too loose, there's too many chances that this is just going to be sloppy. And I want it not to fall out once it's in there. I want it to actually be secure. From there, I'm going to set it up in a jig and solder it in place. And I'll probably shoot that video as well. So. Okay, so this is after the soldering is done. The spring barrel is attached. I've got a mandrel sitting inside of the spring barrel that's inside of the lathe chuck. And what I do is each pump gets checked to see for concentricity. And if you can see the dial, we're getting maybe a half a thousandth of run out at the end, which means that this pump is actually nice and straight. Okay, the last step, again, I'm talking off camera. The last step is honing. We have a chuck set up in the sun and hone that has a mandrel on it that's sized specifically for the spring barrel. It's got cutting fluid flowing over it, and we use a set of outside stones. I've already done the rough honing on this, so now it's just the finished size honing. This is the same pump that I was working with before, so I know it's a piece of junk. I'm not going to use it for anything. And what I'm looking for when I'm doing this is a really even movement. I don't want to push down, I don't want to pull up, I don't want to twist as I'm doing it. You just want to stay nice and even. Be as much of the machine as you can be. Let the stones cut. As you're riding on just the little solder joint that's here, you do not want to put too much pressure on this with the stones. You're going to check it periodically for size. I have a micrometer that I keep in the cone because it's always oily. So, and if I were going to use this one, I'm running 635 right now at the top and 635 at the bottom. So it's a thousandth and a half oversized. So in this situation, I'm not going to finish it. It's just going to be a throwaway, so I'm not going to waste more time getting it out of here. So what I would normally do with it is leave it at an oversized if it's going to go on the shelf. If it's going to an instrument, it would go to 635 and a half, as well as all the other pumps would go for that instrument. And then they get assigned. Everything is slippery. But this is what they start to look like when they're honed. That is the piston procedure that I go through to turn one of these into an actual piston. If I got close to the camera, you can see. At any rate, that's all of the components minus the action rod, the finger button, or the guide. That's all the procedures I've got for pistons. So you're not seeing the hand lapping of the valves or anything like that, but those are the steps that I go through to produce pistons for each of our instruments. And I'll keep this really short. I use Monel over stainless because I have Monel and I don't have stainless. I have experience working with Monel. Even though Monel is more difficult to machine, I know how to work with it, so I have no real reason to change. I don't plate my pistons after they're produced with nickel. The nickel plating is harder than the Monel is, but neither is going to wear better than the other when you match it with the valve section itself. Because when you're talking about pistons, you have to remember that it's not just the exterior of this part that's actually wearing. It's also the interior of the valve that's also wearing. And what that is made of is just as important, really, as what the piston is made of. If you used standard 360 brass to produce these parts for the casing tubes, it's pretty soft stuff. In fact, it's actually really soft. It's the softest brass you can actually use. This is actually cartridge brass that are in my valve sections. It's 260 alloy. It's much harder than 360 is. It's more difficult to work with, but it also wears a lot better. So you're matching Monel with cartridge brass. you can get decades and decades and decades out of use, daily use with these, before they start to wear out. So that realistically is all I really need to say about pistons. Benchmark trumpets, they're all handmade here, obviously, in my shop. This is not my shop, this is my back room. So at any rate, this is what we do, and this is an Orion. Thanks for watching. If you want me to make more videos, drop me a comment, send me an email, and we'll see what we can do about that. Thanks.